Nico Vince er tilbake og synger ut for verdensfred. Og 80-tallsikonet Samantha Fox spiller i ny norsk film og har funnet kjærligheten med Linda fra Fredrikstad. Kvelden. Nå, Stian, så skal vi ta inn neste gjest, og det er jo ikke hvem som helst vi har på besøk her i dag. Samantha Fox, hun er altså arbeiderklassejenta som endte opp med å bli et kjempestort globalt sexsymbol og en gigantisk popstjerne. Og nå spiller hun altså i Lange flate baller 3, hvor du også har en rolle. Ikke nok med det, men hun skal altså gifte seg med sin norske kjæreste Linda, som er fra Hvaler og Fredrikstad. Det er jo helt drøyt.
Ja, det er veldig, og jeg merker jo veldig på det. Altså, det her er jo den første dama som man kan huske fra barndommen, som man så med litt mindre klær, da. Og det er jo...
Og... Ja, for du hadde plakatene, ikke?
Ja, ja, altså... Ja, altså... Og det er jo første dama som man, når man ble litt eldre gutt, innså at når man så på... Oi, det er faktisk litt overleit med kvinnfolk med mindre klær også.
Og, så det var en reise der?
Det var en reise, så jeg føler at det var litt sånn, sånn første forelskelse på en måte. Du glemmer jo aldri den første forelskelsen din, og det er litt det samme forholdet har jeg til, til Samantha. Ja. Og det har gjort at jeg er litt sånn der... Jeg blir veldig sånn starstruck, og det er litt sånn... Jeg fikk hilse på premierefesten til Lange Flate Baller, og jeg står og snakker med henne, og det er som at jeg ser at hun ser... Jeg vet hvilke plakater du hadde på veggen, Stian. Jeg har kontroll. Og ja, da blir du, litt sånn, du blir litt sånn stotteret av hele den der situasjonen. Da. Så, litt skummel, men hun viser seg å være en frøktelig koselig dame. Da. Ja.
Ja. Og det skal dere få oppleve nå. Samantha er på vei inn her, men først så har jeg da hentet noen klipp. Blant annet så skal dere få se litt grann av filmen Lange flate baller. Så
so you're a singer?
Ja. Yeah. Det er jo det hun er mest kjent for, Edgar.
Oh, jeg tror hun er mest kjent for...
Day. Slow is the time that we spend apart. The heat is the heat.
Samantha, welcome. It's great to have you here. Og velkommen også til Linda, your future wife. Velkommen til deg også.
Hyggelig å ha deg her.
Now, Stian. What do you reckon about Samantha's version of the Fina steg, right? Which she does in this movie.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
Thank
you. Now I'm going to speak on a little bit Østfold English, but I try my best. It's so beautiful. It was, for me, one of the top moments of the whole movie.
Ah, thank you.
So, Samantha, you being here with your future wife, Linda from Fredrikstad, and you playing in a Norwegian movie, it's just another chapter in an already very fascinating life story
yes.
that you have.
Yes.
And let's go back to the beginning. Yeah. Because there's a long-standing tradition in the UK for the tabloids to print pictures of pretty young girls in underwear.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you entered that world. How did that yeah. happen? What was your first photo shoot?
There was a competition in the newspaper on a Sunday. It was all typical Sunday. We'd had our roast dinner. We were looking at the Sunday tabloids. And it said, girls, you can be the face and shape of 83. Mm-hmm. And I was getting a lot of interest with boys at that time. And I wanted to enter it. Yeah. So I said, oh, I'd love to enter that competition. So we went up, we rang a friend called Terry, who we knew she owned some sexy underwear. My mum didn't, you know, she'd been married quite a while. And she did the photo shoot. My nan was there and she was sitting on my bed, holding a bedside lamp onto my face to give me some nice light.
You okay?
I know, my grandmother. And we sent that in. It was a very small picture like this. And on the back, my mum wrote, 36, 23, 31.
Which is your measurements?
Yes, yeah. yes. and very small hips for very big boobs. So it was very unusual. And most of the girls who entered, I think, oh, there was maybe 20, 30,000 girls who entered this competition. And the photographer said, I just had to look at it. And then he looked at my measurements and he said, I reminded him of his wife, who was a very famous model in the 70s. And in actual fact, she was the first nude on the front page of the Times. She made history. Right. And you didn't see everything, of course, but it was a beautiful shot.
And then you took it to the next level, because at one point, a huge record company was looking for the British Madonna.
They was, yeah.
Yeah, and then they had 1,000 girls coming in for auditions,
yeah,
and they chose you. And then Touch Me is released, and then all of a sudden, you have a number one hit in 17 countries.
Yeah, and top 10 most of the world. It's like, and America, too, it went to number three. Not many British women were breaking America at that time.
But do you remember when you realised that you had actually made it also as a pop artist?
As a pop star?
Yeah. Is there like a moment there?
I guess as a glamour model, I was only really famous in England. Mm. But this, and suddenly, you know, I think it was my first going on holiday to Spain and everyone just recognising me on the beach. And that was like, ah. And I guess the first time was when I was just about to shoot the video for Touch Me. And the evening before, I went on a show like this for the BBC. And I sang Touch Me, and then I very cheekily said at the end, because it was live, right, everybody, I'm shooting a video tomorrow. Please come down and you can be in my video. Well, every kid in London, I think, truanted that day. And they all came, and the actual club that we did it in was a big club. It was under these tunnels. And there were so many, there were thousands and thousands of people, and they broke through the glass. And the police cars couldn't get in because it was a tunnel, so they had to send in police horses with policemen and horses. And, like, my bodyguards were telling me, you can't believe what's going on out there. We might not be able to do this video. Anyway, we let... I think there was 600 who got in, and it was just crazy. I mean, that was the first time I really realised that I was so famous, you know.
And then, after all these incredible experiences, you ended up meeting a Norwegian woman.
I did.
Linda. And I think I have to... I'm going to hear you, Linda. Maybe we should do this in English. It's better, for,
yeah,
because then Sam understands as well. You have been a fan of Samantha for quite a while, haven't you?
Yeah, I didn't have any poster like Stian had, but, yeah, I was collecting her pictures and I was swapping with my friends and... Yeah, I loved her style, her hair, her ripped jeans, and yeah, obviously very beautiful. So, yeah.
So, and when did you meet her?
Yeah, like 20 years years after, I suddenly saw like advertising that she was going to do Wheel of the 80s, Telenor Arena.
Yeah.
So I bought a ticket and bought meet and greet ticket. And, yeah, we had the instant connection,
didn't we? Did you want to meet me, baby?
Huh? Yeah, definitely. Yes.
And so you had a connection just then when you met?
Oh, straight away. Yeah. As I walked towards her, she's always got this beautiful smile and she's got the most beautiful eyes, and I just saw my future with her, and we just got on like this, and, yeah, I saw her soul through her eyes, and I don't know, it was magic. And if people don't believe in love at first sight, they should, because it hits you like nothing else.
She asked me.
And then I asked her out. I've not asked many people out in my life, and my management had her number because she wrote to my office asking about concerts and what other concerts she could come to.
Right.
And I asked my management, I said, you know that girl I met tonight? You haven't got her number, have you? And he went, why? I said, oh, I'm going to ring her up and ask her on a date. He said, you're joking. I said, no, I'm going to. Why not? What's the worst can happen? She could only say no.
And then you got the call.
Yeah, first I got the text and said, oh, thank you for the lovely picture on Facebook. It was lovely and blah, blah, blah. And I thought it was a fan, another fan of her. And then somebody was calling all the time, more and more texts. I was like, who's that?
I was like, how dare she not answer me?
Yeah.
I can't believe it. She's playing hard to get.
Yeah. And then she left a voice message. And I was thinking, yeah, I better listen to it then. And I was like,
ah! And that was the beginning of it all.
But that was many years after we met the first time. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It was.
Okay. And so the rest is history, is that what you say, yeah?
I couldn't forget her. I just had to ring her. I just had to.
People ask. From Østfold usually have the effect.
Yeah.
So now the two of you live in London with one of Linda's sons. The other one lives here in Norway. But the first thing you did was that you invited Sam to come camping with you,
yeah,
out in Varder,
yes,
this summer paradise.
See why? How down to earth she
was.
She go
was to... testing me.
Yeah, she could go to utedass. Yeah, she was more hardcore than me.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I love camping. Yeah, maybe I'm not that hardcore in the way that I took three suitcases there.
For camping.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't sure if it was going to rain, if it was going to be cold, so I packed a lot of jumpers and, and my pajamas and sleeping bags. To get off the boat over the rocks to the island.
Oh, people was laughing.
It was all laughing. We didn't look like seasoned campers at all, but we are now. We have backpacks now. We're very cool.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So, what is your favourite part of that camping in a deserted island in Hvaler?
I just love the peace and. The peace and the beauty, and just in the morning to open the tent and see the ocean, and I just love the simple. I like the simple things in life. I've been in the business nearly 40 years, and I've stayed in some of the best hotels in the world, and in the end they can all look the same. Mm. But to me, camping is something so far removed, and you know, at the end of the day, my nan and granddad had caravan when I was a kid. My favourite. The time was always spending my school holidays with them. Mm. So I love the outdoor life and I love that camping life and I can be myself and, yeah, there's no paparazzi. I mean, without them, I wouldn't be here now. I know, I thank the paparazzi very much. Mm-hmm. But that there I can just totally be chilled and relaxed. And I love cooking on the little fire and making breakfast and...
I can picture this. Camping bliss.
Yeah.
In Fredrikstad.
Yeah.
Blir ikke bedre enn det.
Nei. Det blir det ikke. Nei.
Samantha, it's been great having you here. You're releasing an album shortly and also traveling and touring together with Linda.
Yeah, so, she's great company. And you know, back in the day when my dad was my manager, I was often quite lonely, really. And having Linda with me, having my beautiful future wife with me, and you know, I trust her implicitly. And if I look terrible, she'll tell me. You know, if my hair's funny at the back, she'll sort it out. You know, she's just lovely to have because it's cozy and it's lovely. So when we do the gig, we go back to the hotel, we have room service, we watch movies, and we're together. Mm. Because this business can be a lonely business. Mm. I mean, have you ever found that?
Yeah.
Sometimes you can be in front of thousands and thousands of people, then you end up all alone in your hotel room. Mm. And you think, it's weird. This is weird, you know, because you can be up there one minute and down there the next. Mm. And it can be a lonely life, but you have to keep great friends with you, keep sticking with your family and real people around you. And lucky enough to have my girlfriend travel with me, which is fabulous.
Good luck to the both of you with all of that. And Stian, utrolig stas å ha deg på besøk som alltid. Takk skal dere ha, begge to. I morgen er det seriestart i fotballen, og det gir oss en glimrende anledning til å snakke om det fotball.